People with disabilities have much lower rates of employment than people who don't have disabilities in Australia. And equal opportunity is something that we hear a lot about. But is equal opportunity really enough? There's a new organisation called Australians for Disability and Diversity Employment. I think I got that right. We've got some guests here tonight. We've got David Sullivan, Amanda McNeil and Peter Rickards. You guys are from Australians for Disability and Diversity Employment. I hope I got that right.
You certainly
yep,
did.
Yep, that's it.
Right. Peter, yes. You're the president. Can you tell us a bit about the organisation?
Well, we started only 7th of September last year, and basically because many of us who have disabilities and from other disadvantaged groups are not getting a fair go in employment. And it doesn't matter how much the government's putting money into employment support services, it's not actually resulting in increased employment opportunities for people with disabilities. So we believe that a lot more needs to be done. So we have set ourselves up to advocate for change and to try and create employment opportunities for ourselves as well.
Mm. David, what are your priorities as far as advocating within employment and diversity within employment?
Yeah, it's a good question because the field is very large in total, of course. First off, I guess we try to make sure that we're dealing with the questions, obvious questions of discrimination against people with disability or with some other part of themselves, part of their system, part of their makeup. And it's very interesting to deal with that first part first, because clearly we have to deal with the negative parts of it first. But down the track a bit, we're thinking more in terms of looking at the whole range of disability and diversity, because we know it's important to get a range right across the board.
Mm. Yep.
Society is made up of those different people, so we believe that everybody, that employment should be as well.
I think in fairness though, and perhaps Amanda you'd like to comment on this too, that the federal government, Johnny Howard, is trying to do something about employing people with disabilities, as he would say. They've changed the workplace modifications system very recently. They've widened the criteria and they've made it less bureaucratic, so you don't have to go through brokerage services anymore. And they've put $25 million into the system over the next 3 years. That's obviously a positive step, but there's also secondary things like the fact that care services are very inflexible and that sort of thing. How would you say those things impact upon employment or full participation, Amanda?
I would say that other issues tend to come into it, like insurance, access to interviews. I mean, things like the recruitment services for employers are, I think, a major problem. These recruiters are hire companies who are paid for by the employer, and they want to get the job of recruiting someone done as cheaply as possible. And that by its very nature, excludes people with disabilities.
How do you think the new IR changes and AWAs have affected people from diverse backgrounds gaining employment?
Well, I think they haven't helped. And basically, I think what needs to happen is that there needs to be a change of attitude from the top of organisations, starting from the federal government, state and local governments. They need to be leading from the front. And unfortunately, the Howard government has statistics show that percentage of people with disabilities in the federal public service has dropped from 5.6% to about 3% in the last 10 years. Right. So. The government saying one thing and doing the opposite. And
what could they do to make it better, though? What would you, if you
well,
were talking
need,
to...
Well, they need to be proactive and take an attitude that from the top down there will be a commitment to having disability and diversity workplace policies in the public service. Then the government can go out and say to other organisations, we're doing the right thing, here we are, we have the runs on the board, you can follow by our example, and that's what they're not doing first off.
And sorry.
You go, babe.
I was just going to say, with equal opportunity, what people are really talking about is having a lack of discrimination in the employment process. Are you guys actually saying that there should be an element of positive discrimination?
I think so, yes. affirmative action, I think, is really required, because you need to provide a fair and equal employment. You need to get people into the workplace, employed, and providing a service. Like,
playing devil's advocate though for a sec, Amanda, how would you counter the argument that a lot of people make that once you use affirmative action, and women copped a lot of this in the 70s, people see these roles as, oh, the job for the disabled, or in the worst possible cases, I've heard people go, oh, they're the speckos jobs, you know, in far less educated work environments. So how would you get over the problem of the perceptions in the workplace about those roles?
I think by having, as Peter was saying, by having a policy of diversity, of inclusion of all, and by having measurable targets, that workplace is, you'll be able to demonstrate that over time that workplace is the one that provides the best, not only employment for the individual, but the best service to its client group or customers.
If I was an employer though, I'd be actually wanting to employ the best person for the job, ultimately. And I think because we've been working with employment recruiters, and what we've found is they actually don't have the skills nor the training to work with diverse backgrounds. Now, I'm generalising here, but the ones that specifically that I've been working with intellectual disabilities have lacked the skills to set up strategies within the employment places. Now, I've also found employers, though, have tried to actually pull in a whole lot of small roles to make a job, instead of actually seeing how those small roles can be flanged out to actually employ people. So, you know, some people can only work 2 hours a day, or, you know, things along those lines. So it's about being a little bit more lateral, I think, when you're an employer, and I think employers need to be educated. What do you think about training and education of both employment agencies and employers?
I think once you know what you're shooting for, things will be very much assisted. One of our biggest challenges at the moment is we think we have to go out to find out what the picture really is. All of us around this table have ideas and thoughts about perhaps how employment is organised now, but actually we don't know, and that's why we're very keen to do much more study, much more survey, much more information gathering to find out what the picture really is now before suggesting the way that you take it.
I know it sounds like you're well on the way. So how can people contact Australians for Disability and Diversity in Employment?
Well, we're in the process of setting up a website. We're an organisation that's newly formed. We don't have any resources, we don't have a big office, we don't have any paid staff at this point in time.
Give us the number, Pete. Come on, speak out, mate.
Give us my number.
0407 509 117.
Fantastic. Well, good luck in your work. It sounds like you're doing some fantastic research and some fantastic stuff. So if our viewers want to know more, they can contact you guys. Thank you for coming in. That's about all we've got time for. So stay tuned, we'll be back right after this short break.